But I don't think it's got a thing to do with reward and punishment. Religion is always in the control business. And that's something people don't really understand. It's in the guilt-producing control business. And if you have heaven as a place where you're rewarded for your goodness and hell as a place where you're punished for your evil, then you sort of have control of the population. And so they create this fiery place, which has quite literally scared the hell out of a lot of people throughout Christian history.
Mm-hmm.
And it's part of a control tactic.
But wait a minute, you're saying that hell, the idea of a place under the earth or somewhere where you're tormented for an eternity, is actually an invention the church?
I think the church fired its furnaces hotter than anybody else. But I think there's a sense in most religious life of reward and punishment in some form. The church doesn't like for people to grow up, because you can't control grown-ups. That's why we talk about being born again. When you're born again, you're still a child. The people don't need to be born again. They need to grow up. They need to accept their responsibility for themselves and the world.
What do you make of the theology, which is pretty quite prominent these days in America, which is that there is one guaranteed way not to go to hell, and that is to accept Jesus as your personal Savior?
Yeah, I grew up in that tradition. Every church I know claims that we are the true church, and they have some ultimate authority. We have the infallible Pope. We have the inerrant Bible. The idea that the truth of God can be bound in any human system, by any human creed, by any human book, is almost beyond imagination for me. I mean, God is not a Christian. God is not a Jew or a Muslim or a Hindu or a Buddhist. All of those are human systems which human beings have created to try to help us walk into the mystery of God. I honor my tradition. I walk through my tradition. But I don't believe my tradition defines God. I think it only points me to God.
You and I are emerging people, not fallen people. Our problem is not that we are born in sin. Our problem is we do not yet know how to achieve being fully human. The function of the Christ is not to rescue the sinners, but to empower you and to call you to be more deeply and fully human than you've ever realized there was the potential within you to be. Maybe salvation needs to be conveyed in terms of enhancing your humanity rather than rescuing you from it.
Life is a startling and wondrous experience. And eventually, I think we're going to discover that God is unfolding through the life of our consciousness and our self-consciousness and is not a parent figure up in the sky. But I believe because I'm related to something that is not bound by time and space, that I will share in whatever God's eternity is.
The more you begin to investigate what we think we understand, where we came from, what we think we're doing, the more you begin to see we've been lied to. We've been lied to by every institution. What makes you think for 1 minute that the religious institution is the only one that's never been touched? The religious institutions of this world are at the bottom of the dirt. The religious institutions in this world are put there by the same people who gave you your government, your corrupt education, who set up your international banking cartels, because our masters don't give a damn about you or your family. All they care about is what they have always cared about, and that's controlling the whole damn world. We have been misled away from the true and divine presence in the universe that men have called God. I don't know what God is, but I know what He isn't. And unless and until you are prepared to look at the whole truth, and wherever it may go, whoever it may lead to, if you want to look the other way, or if you want to play favorites, then somewhere along the line you're going to find out you're messing with divine justice. The more you educate yourself, the more you understand where things come from, the more obvious things become. And you begin to see lies everywhere. You have to know the truth and seek the truth, and the truth will set you free.
Is God willing to prevent evil, but not able? Then He is not omnipotent. Is He able, but not willing? then he is malevolent.
In making this series, I've inevitably discovered that the history of faith and doubt is a great deal more complicated than it might seem.
Is God both able and willing? Then whence cometh evil? Is he neither able nor willing? Then why call him God?
My inquiry has been helped by conversations I've had with historians, writers, scientists, and philosophers.
I think most people who say they believe in God, most people in the West who say they believe in God, actually believe in belief in God.
Well, I tried to be a religious person when I was 12, 13, 14. It lasted about 2 years.
People are so used to the idea that complicated things in our human world are indeed designed and made. But when you've said, oh, it was designed by God, you've explained absolutely nothing.
A week maybe, or a few days after the September 11 disaster, there was a huge service here in New York City, and I watched it on television, and people were singing, "The Lord is my shepherd." And a friend was watching the same program on television, told me, "Wow, some shepherd."
It's some years since I was on the Staten Island ferry, and when I last looked back at it from here, the skyline was dominated by the twin towers of the World Trade Center. It seems quite odd to think of it in the light of religion, but its absence now reminds me of the religious implications of what one saw on television on that hideous day. And although when it happened, many people said it was a cowardly act, atrocious it certainly was, it really is quite hard to see it as cowardly exactly, since it was perpetrated by people who sacrificed themselves in the certain knowledge of their forthcoming death. It's inconceivable that it could have been done without religion. For it's only in the name of some sort of absolute assurance of a permanent life after death that someone would be willing to undertake such an act. And we know that the men who did so did it in the name of a religion which they upheld against a society whose lack of religion, as they saw it, they deplored, and whose support of Jewish claims in what is called the Holy Land they were implacably opposed to. Therefore, the conspicuous absence of the Twin Towers, involving as it does the inherent conflicts between Christianity, Islam, and Judaism, is, I think, one of the most powerful expressions of religious fanaticism in the late 20th and early 21st centuries. Understandably for Americans, the events of September the 11th aroused tremendous feelings of hostility towards the religion in whose name the terrorist act had apparently been performed. It drew attention to the difference between them, the Americans on the one hand, and the Muslim world. But it's important to remember that you only have to travel a few miles from New York City to find yourself in the middle of a country which, far from being the secular world which was deplored and attacked by the Islamic fundamentalists, is in fact intensely Christian, and therefore in its own way, of course, just as religious as the Muslim world that attacked it. But for someone like myself, who has nothing that you could possibly call a religious belief or even feeling, the spectacle of September the 11th is a forceful reminder of the potentially destructive power of the three great monotheistic religions that have dominated the world in one way or another for nearly 2,000 years.
Hello everyone. I want to talk for a moment about beliefs and how we come to believe something, or more specifically, how we do not come to believe in something. I think most Christians are under the impression that beliefs are arbitrary choices one makes. Choose to believe that Jesus was God's son and you'll be saved. Well, this line of reasoning is demonstrably erroneous. The problem is that beliefs are obviously not the result of conscious choices we make. We don't decide to believe in something. Our beliefs are systematically beat into submission by evidence. We simply form conclusions based upon the best available evidence at our disposal. Did you choose to believe that your car exists? Did you choose to believe that the shirt you're wearing exists? Or did you choose to believe that the earth is not flat? Well, of course you didn't choose to believe any of these things. Once the evidence for each was presented to you, your beliefs were forced to submit to your new knowledge. Don't believe me? Try for a moment to convince yourself that leprechauns exist. Go ahead, close your eyes if you need to. I'll give you a minute. So how'd that work out for you? I'm willing to wager that, despite your best efforts, you were unable to actually believe that leprechauns do in fact exist. What if there were incentives, though? Let's say that if you can believe in leprechauns, I'll write you a $1,000 check. That's right, 1,000 free buckaroos if you can, honest to God, believe in leprechauns. Free cash, no strings attached. All you have to do is consciously will yourself to believe that leprechauns exist. If that's not doing it for you, let's add another incentive. For kicks and giggles, let's say that if you are unable to believe in leprechauns, you'll have the worst luck for the rest of your life. That's right, you'll never find a fiver laying on the ground, and if you do happen to stumble upon a penny, bless your heart, it's gonna be heads down. You'll never win the lottery, and if in general there is any aspect of your life in which luck might play a role, you're gonna get screwed. All this for not believing in leprechauns. So how are you doing at this point? Are you a believer in leprechauns yet? I'm still willing to bet that none of you actually are. It's not that the reward doesn't sound nice or that we wouldn't mind the punishment. It's that there's no good reason to believe that leprechauns actually exist. If you were offered this situation, surely it would benefit you to believe in leprechauns. Hey, you get free cash. So it's obviously not a matter of wanting or not wanting to believe it. Alas, evidence will always win. It'll corner you and beat you senseless until you give in to it. I mean, good luck standing in front of your car and admitting that you don't believe it exists. But this is a big problem for Christianity. Ignoring for a moment that the Bible is entirely unclear on the simple question of how one attains salvation, let's assume that this is accomplished through loving Jesus or accepting Him as your Savior, whatever that means. Well, in order to love Jesus, isn't it imperative to first believe that He exists? Is it possible to love something that you do not believe exists? So then, why does God demand our belief in Him, when He should very well know that we have absolutely no choice in the matter? And surely He should know that threats of punishment and promises of paradise will not be able to sway our beliefs one way or the other. It's not that I wouldn't love to go to heaven. I'd love to see my friends and family after I die. And it's not that I don't find the prospects of hell frightening. I do. But these threats are useless when it comes to my mind's assessment of reality. I can no more choose to believe in God than I can choose to believe in leprechauns. And when you come to accept this idea, it really cuts Christianity down to a point in which it can't get up. It pretty much is the final nail in the coffin. After all, why would God make belief the one key in escaping hell's fiery wake if we're not even able to choose our beliefs? That just doesn't seem fair. But hey, God loves you! And remember, folks, a little skepticism can go a long way.